All my dear students, I am CMA Smita Rimali. Today we are going to talk on the subject Business Regulatory Framework. There in chapter The Sale of Goods Act 1930 and the topic Doctrine of Caveat Emptor. In the earlier session we have discussed the basic introductory part on Sale of Goods Act as well as the meaning and difference between conditions and warranties, essentials of Sale of Goods Act, etc. In this session we will discuss about the meaning of the doctrine caveat emptor, exceptions to this rule, and also the sale by non-owner. So this video contains first doctrine of caveat emptor, exceptions to the rule of doctrine, thereafter transfer of goods by non-owner, and also exception to the said transfer. Let us understand this one by one. The first concept is doctrine of caveat emptor. So my dear friends, as per this doctrine of caveat emptor, even though the doctrine seems to be difficult, but the meaning is very easy. It is nothing but the buyer should be aware. So the Latin term defines it as buyers beware. Means whenever any buyer is purchasing anything from the seller, while purchasing anything, the buyer should be aware that what he is purchasing and for why he is purchasing, and also whether or not the goods which he is purchasing are as per his requirement or not. So it means that the buyer is warned to protect his interest. Means the buyer should be enough aware about to protect his interest for self. So he should not always depend upon the seller to protect the buyers. It is the duty of buyer himself to protect from any fraud or any mismanipulation from the seller. How? You can see from the next definition. According to this doctrine, the buyer should be careful while purchasing goods suitable for his own purposes. So it is a duty of buyer should be very careful while purchasing the goods which are suitable for his own purposes. Hence, if the buyer has not made any inquiry regarding the goods, the seller is not under any obligation to disclose every defect in the goods of which he may be aware. So it protects the seller from the buyer. Why? Because this doctrine says it is the duty of the buyer to check every essential requirement of the goods. It is not a duty of the seller to disclose every defect of the goods, but it is the duty of the buyer who is going to purchase the goods to check the goods before purchasing. So this doctrine says buyer should be aware. If goods fail to satisfy the requirements of the buyer, he cannot hold the seller responsible for the same. Once the buyer has purchased the goods, after seeing all necessary things in the goods, and afterwards, if the buyer finds the goods are not satisfying his requirement, he cannot hold the seller responsible that he has not sold the goods which is required by the buyer. It is a duty of the buyer, before purchasing the goods, he should check it. Sometimes it is difficult for the buyer to inspect each and every kinds of goods and confirm that such goods will satisfy his requirements. It may happen that the buyer is not in a condition all the time to check every goods or every kind of goods and confirm that the goods are really as per his requirement. So there can be some cases where the buyer cannot identify the satisfaction level the goods is going to provide. In that case, the buyer, hence if the buyer communicates to the seller the type of goods he wants to purchase and relies totally on him, then the seller is under obligation to supply goods suitable for the buyer. Here there is exception that if buyer already told to the seller that he wants a particular type of goods and for a particular requirement, and if the buyer is totally relies on the seller, and if the seller is not providing him such required goods, then the seller will be responsible. So the Sale of Goods Act have provided some exceptions to the rule of doctrine of caveat emptor. That means, as per like this case which we have all just discussed, the Sale of Goods Act have given some exception to the rule of buyer be aware. Which are those? We will study. So there are some exceptions to the rule of caveat emptor. These are some exceptions to this rule. The first exception is misrepresentation by the seller. If the seller has misrepresentingly sold some goods to the buyer and the buyer relies on the misrepresentation made by the seller, in that case we cannot hold buyer responsible if such goods are not as per the requirements of the buyer. If the seller has given any misinformation or misleading information about the goods. Second, concealment of latent defect. If the seller is already known of the defect and afterwards the buyer is known about the defect, and even though he is known about the defect, the seller hiding such defect from the buyer can also claim for such defect. Thereafter, fraud by the seller. If fraudulently the seller sold goods to the buyer, in that case also there is exception given to the rule of caveat emptor. Hence it protects the buyer. Listen, it protects the buyer from the seller. The rule actually protects the seller from the buyer, but because of these exceptions the rule has given exceptions and hence it protects the buyers. Thereafter, sale by description. If seller has made any sale according to some descriptions given to the buyer, and even though the buyer relies on that, it also have same effect that the buyer should be aware it is not the case. Thereafter, sale by sample. Same as of sale by description, sale of sample is also when the seller sell any goods as per the sample, and if buyer founds afterwards that the goods are not as per the sample, he may claim for damages. There are some other exceptions also, sale by sample as well as description. So this also has the same effect as of sale of sample and description. Fitness for a particular purpose. If the buyer has purchased any goods for the fitness purpose, and if that goods are not giving him fitness purpose, then the buyer have a right to claim for damages or return the goods. Mercantile quality. If the buyer has purchased the goods, relies upon the seller as to the mercantility of the goods, and if the goods are not as per the mercantility quality, again the buyer can return the goods to the seller. And also trade and usage. If the goods are purchased with the intent of trade or usage in the course of action, and if it is not as per the such trade and usage criteria, then also this is given exception to the buyer that he can return the goods and the seller will be held responsible. आई होप यू हैव अंडरस्टूड दिस डेफिनेशन ऑफ डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ कैवियट एमटर, दैट इज बायर शुड बी अवेयर एंड देर आर सम एक्सेप्शंस जस्ट वी हैव रीड अबाउट इन विच केसेस इट इज नॉट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ द बायर टू बी अवेयर बट इट इज द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ द सेलर टू गेट द बायर अवेयर. Now, the next concept is transfer of title by non-owners. With the name itself, you can see the meaning of this term, transfer of title by non-owners. So, the goods are transferred or the title of goods is transferred by the person who is not the actual owner of the goods. What will happen in this case? When ownership of goods is to be transferred from the seller to the buyer, it presumes that the seller is an absolute owner of the goods, and on transfer of ownership, the buyer also becomes an absolute owner of the goods. What this says, when any transaction of sale and purchase is conducted, it is presumed that the seller, the goods which he is going to sell to the buyer, the seller has actual ownership of the goods which he is going to sell to the buyer, and after sale the buyer has absolute ownership of the goods after the sale is executed. But if the seller is not an absolute owner of the goods, the buyer will not get an absolute ownership of the goods. If the seller is not the owner, even though he sells goods to another person, that person will also not get ownership of the goods. It means no one can give what he has not. If the seller don't have ownership of the goods, he cannot sell that goods to another person and give him the ownership, because he himself don't have ownership of that goods. This is called as transfer of title by non-owner. Now, what will happen in such case? This rule is made for protecting the interest of true owner of the goods. It may happen the person who is selling the goods to another person might be stolen the goods from anyone, and then he is selling goods to the next one. So, to protect the interest of the true owner, this rule is made. Hence, the buyer cannot acquire a good title to the goods unless he buys the goods from a person who is absolute owner of the goods or who has the authority to sell the goods. If the goods are in actual ownership of the seller, only he has the authority to sell it, otherwise not. This rule has certain exceptions. Again, to this rule, there are certain exceptions. Which are those exceptions? First, an unauthorized sale by a mercantile agent. If the mercantile agent is selling goods on behalf of their true owner, in that case, the agent does not have the ownership of the goods. Still, as an agent, his duty is to sell the goods. He can sell that. So even though he is not the owner, he can have the right to resell it because he is an agent. Sale by one of the joint owners. It is also authorized. If one of the joint owner has sold the good, it is also applicable. Sale by buyer in possession. In many times it happens the buyer has the possession of it, and many of days has gone and the true owner has not identified. In that case, the seller or that person can again sell it. Resale of goods by an unpaid seller. If any person has not paid the prices of the goods and the seller has waited it for so many days, and if even though the buyer has not paid the amount, in that case the seller can resell it. sale by finder of the goods. It may happen if any person finds the good somewhere and even after inquiry he has not found the true owner, he can sell the goods. Thereafter, sale by pawnee. So if the right have been given to another person to sell, that person can also execute the sale. Sale by official receiver or assignee. In case of any assignment contract, the official receiver have right given to treat the goods or treat the assets in whatever way he can. In that case, he can sell it by on his own. A holder in due course. Many times it happens, particular goods may get travel from one person to another, and after a very long period of time, it gets in the hands of a particular person, and that particular person is called as a holder in due course. So this person has a right to sell it, and again a holder in due course. So thank you so much. I hope you have understood the meaning of term caveat emptor and the definition or the rule of transfer by non-owner.